Hi everybody, in this video we're going to be looking at our third type of hypothesis tests, and that would be for standard deviations. So again, this is very similar to the other ones we've already looked at. We do have a different test statistic now, and the test statistic for standard deviations uses the chi-squared distribution. So we saw this again back at the confidence intervals as well. So for this example here, we've got a claim that the pulse rates among men have standard deviation less than 10 beats per minute. So we want to test this claim that's about a standard deviation of the population. So in order to do that, we take a sample, in this case of 40 men, so we have an n value of 40. Their average pulse rate was 73.6 beats per minute, so that is the average of the sample, and then the standard deviation of the sample is 9.7 beats per minute. And we're going to use significance level 0.05. So to start, we need to determine what our claims look like. So our original claim is that our standard deviation of the population, sigma, is less than 10 beats per minute. So sigma less than 10. That means that our opposite claim would be sigma greater than or equal to 10. And then from here we can say, all right, H0, our null hypothesis would be sigma equals 10, and our alternative hypothesis would be sigma less than 10. And again, if you are unsure about how to come up with these, you should go back and watch the first video about hypothesis tests to get that sort of overall procedure. Now, based upon this alternative hypothesis, we know that this is going to be a one-tailed test. In this case, it's a left-tailed test since we have something less than 10. And then we're going to compute our test statistic. So our test statistic here is fairly simple to compute. We've got n minus 1, so in this case that would be 39, times the sample standard deviation, 9.7 squared, and then divided by our population standard deviation, and again, this is the population standard deviation that we're assuming for the null hypothesis. This would be a 10 squared. And this computes to be 37.83. And while in theory you could use either the p-value method or the critical value method, we actually do not have a calculator program on the standard TI-83 or 84 for this. So just to make our calculations easier, we're going to opt for the critical value method on all of the standard deviation problems. So for our critical value method, we're imagining drawing a distribution. Now this distribution is a chi-squared distribution, so really I should actually draw it a little bit lopsided. These are not symmetric distributions. They tend to have a longer tail on the right. Now because this was a left-tailed test, I'm expecting to look at the left tail here. And again, it doesn't really matter how you draw this. This is just for a visual. So here our critical region is supposed to have area corresponding to our alpha value. So for this problem, we were using a significance level of 0.05. So this would have area 0.05. And you'll notice that this is area to the left of our critical value. So here's our critical value. This is some kind of chi-squared value, and we're going to look in the chi-squared table. Now remember, the area is given in the chi-squared table, it says, is the area to the right rather than to the left. So if our area to the left here is 0.05, then our area to the right is 0.95. So we're going to look for the chi-squared value where the area to the right is 0.95, and our degrees of freedom is, again, one less than the sample size, which in this case it would come out to 39. Now 39 is not in the table, so we'll go ahead and use 40 since that's the closest. And then we're going to look for area to the right of 0.95, and this gives us a chi-squared value of 26.509. So we look at our test statistics, which was about 38, and say, is this in the critical region? Now, 38 would be somewhere to the right of 26, right? It's a little bit bigger, which means that this is not in the critical region. And since it's not in the critical region, we will not reject H0. So our conclusion here is fail to reject H0. If we put this in the context of this problem, we're failing to reject the null hypothesis, which means that there's not enough information to say that our alternative hypothesis is true. So we would write this out as, there is not enough information to support the claim that the standard deviation of men's pulses is less than 10 beats per minute. If we think about this logically, we did a sample, and the average of the sample, or the standard deviation of the sample, actually is less than 10 beats per minute, but not very, very much. So there's a fairly good chance that the average is actually more than 10 beats per minute, and we just happen to see a smaller number here. If the sample had found a standard deviation a lot smaller, maybe like 5 beats per minute, then we probably would be able to support our claim. Or if our sample size had been bigger, we probably would have been able to support our claim. But as it stands, this is not enough evidence to say, yes, we think that the standard deviation is less than 10. It might be, but we can't conclude that here. To finish up, here's a problem for you to try, and that's it for this video. See you next time.